أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
The last thing I want to share with you before, and this is again the introduction, the last part of my introduction, is that when we read the Quran or when we try to understand the Quran, there are some things I want you to deconstruct in your mind. Deprogram, get them out of your system. The first of those things is, this is a book for knowledgeable people. This is a book for people that have a lot of knowledge, that are very well versed in religion, that are scholars or imams or speakers or khatibs or you name it. That's who this book is for. I want you to let this out of your mind, that when you read the Quran you're thinking, this book this book is a very academic kind of exercise. Oh, it's a religious, spiritual text. I don't even want you to think about it like that first. You know what I want you to think about it like? You know when you have a real problem? A lot of us have problems. We have family problems. We have marriage problems. We have problems with our in-laws. But you say that's normal, right? So there's a problem with our in-laws. Some of you have problems with your kids. Some kids have problems with their parents. Friends have problems with each other. Some of you have problems at work. Some of you have problems in business. We have all kinds of problems. And when people have really bad problems, you know what they do? They go talk to a friend. Now, can I talk to you? This thing is really bothering me. And you call a friend and you're on the phone with them for an hour talking about your problem. Right? This is what most of us do. And hopefully people you talk to about your problems are in your family. But for most of us, the problem is the family, so you got to find somebody else. Right? And this gave birth to really a gigantic scam industry, even though there are some very legitimate psychologists out there, but a lot of therapists are just crooks. They'll call you over, charge you $350 an hour and say, tell me how you feel. Tell me about your problems. And you'll talk about your problems for an hour, and at the end of that they'll say, do you feel better? I'll say, no, you're supposed to tell me something. I was like, no, my way of getting you to feel better is to talk about your problems. But you know, when we talk to Allah about our problems, then He gives us counsel. He gives us therapy. He gives us advice. That's what the Qur'an is supposed to be. When you're having problems, and all of us do have problems, the Qur'an is supposed to be Allah giving you and me very relevant advice for my life and your life. It's a personal relationship. It's not an academic relationship. It's not this superficial kind of relationship. First and foremost, it's a personal relationship. And when Allah is giving instructions, even when He's telling stories of the past, you're supposed to not be thinking only about the past. What should you be thinking about? Yourself. I'll give you one example of that and I'll go on. I'll give you a scary example of that. Not only should the Muslim be thinking about himself when he's listening to the Qur'an says or teaches us that even the kafir, the one who hates the message of the Qur'an, the one who disbelieves in the message of the Qur'an, when they listen to the Qur'an, even they shouldn't be thinking about the past, they should be thinking about themselves. Where did I get this from? I told you two surahs mention a lot of stories of previous prophets. Which two surahs did I highlight today? Hud and Shu'ara, right? Hud, 11 and 26. And Surah Hud once again. Very interesting phenomenon. I was actually sharing this with some brothers this morning. And later this evening at iftar. Allah decided to destroy the nation of Lut. You know that? Allah decided to destroy the nation of Lut. You know how He decided to destroy them? فَإِذَا جَاءَ أَمْرُنَا جَعَلْنَا عَالِيَهَا سَافِلَهَا. When our decision came, we decided to make their high points their low points. You know what that means? Their buildings were very high. And Allah said some kind of earthquake, tornado, hurricane, whatever He sent, but those buildings started caving in. The roofs, the ceilings started collapsing. And the buildings are falling apart because of these earthquakes that are coming on this nation. You know what happens when earthquakes happen, right? What are you supposed to do in an earthquake? You're supposed to get out of the building. Especially if it's a minor earthquake, stand underneath the doorways, right? Stand underneath the strong construction. But if it's a major earthquake, get out of the building, be outside. Allah says everything that was high was made low. Not a tree is standing, not a roof is standing, everything's destroyed. When everything's destroyed, many people get crushed. But the people who didn't get crushed, where are they now? They're outdoors. There's no roof left. This was phase one of the punishment. فَأَمْطَرْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ حِجَارَةً مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ حِجَارَةً مِّنْ سِجِّيلٍ مَنْضُودٍ. He says, we started raining on them. Now you have no roof left, you have no tree left, you have no shade left. So when it's raining, do you have anywhere to go? No. What kind of rain was this? A rain made of stones. And then he adds the word manbud, which means, and I think you guys in Houston can appreciate this, you ever heard of this thing called flash floods? Right? The rain comes like a slap, like kush. And you say, okay, it's done. And then 2 seconds later, another slap, like gush. Like it falls like a bucket falls in one shot, instead of light drizzles. Allah says the stones would come from the sky, one big smack. And you would think it's done. Then another layer, then another layer, then another layer. You know, I was giving the younger guys examples because they play a lot of modern warfare or whatever else. It's like brr, brr. It's like that. You know, reload and then again, reload and then again, reload and then again. It kept on coming like that. And then the next ayah tells us something even more scary. Says, musawwamatan. Musawwamatan. Every single pebble had been branded like it had the criminal's name on it. You know how in sniper fire you target very specifically? Every single bullet that Allah sent from the sky was told, this is who you're going to hit, this is where you're going to hit them. Exact targeting. First Allah brought the targets out of the houses. Because if they were still inside the house, you can't hit them. So first Allah shook the houses and got them out of the way. Now they're outdoors, now the firing begins. The firing squad begins. And at the end of all of this, you know what he says? Of course, what nation did I just tell you about? Lut. Lut. And you know who the first people listening to this was? The Quraysh are listening to this. And the Quraysh were listening to this. And to them, this is old history. This is not something that happened that they saw. This is old history for them. Allah says in the same ayah, وَمَا هِيَ لِلظَّالِمِينَ بِبَعِيدٍ. Watch out. For anybody who does wrong, this isn't that far away. For anyone who does wrong, this isn't far away. Who should they be thinking about now? Themselves. Immediately. The history lesson became alive for them. You used to be a party animal yesterday. This Ramadan, you turn back to Allah and you've discovered Islam. And all of a sudden you want to become the preacher in your family and tell everybody that they're wrong and that they're doing haram. Before you do, you need to get a little credibility, don't you? Before you open your mouth, before you start yelling at your uncles, right? Before you start teaching, giving them the khutbah, you come in here the khutbah and you say, I'm going to do this at home. That's a good point. My dad needs to hear this one. This is going to make a great point of argument, right? A lot of excited young people do that. They discover the religion, they hold on to it, and they use it to debate with family. Right? When you do that, you're basically abandoning what the messengers did. You have to have a little credibility first. When you turn to the religion, you become the best son, the best daughter, the best husband, the best wife. Speaking of the best husband, I want to tell you a story. A really good one on this subject. Making people conscious of Allah. You don't just invite people to have taqwa of Allah with your words. Your character says a lot.